Hello, everybody. Welcome. My name is Bennett Tchaikovsky, the accounting professor here on YouTube. This is Wiley Solution Walkthrough from the textbook, Accounting Tools for Business Decision Making. This is the 8th edition, and this is a walkthrough of exercise 14-9. The authors of the textbook are Paul Kimmel, Jerry Weingant, Jill Mitchell. The question used in the presentation is copyright 2022 by John Wiley and Sons. All rights are reserved. This is for educational purposes only. The video may not be distributed or redistributed without the express permission of Wiley. The solution presentation is copyright 2022 by Bennett Tchaikovsky. All rights are reserved. The opinions contained within this presentation are those of Bennett Tchaikovsky and not the authors of the textbook or of Wiley. So let's go. All right, before we say thank you, Wiley, let's go ahead and take a look at this exercise 14-9. So when we look at this question, we're being asked to compute cost of goods manufactured. We're being asked to go through and compute cost of goods sold. And then for those costs that are not included in Part A or Part B, explain how they would be classified and reported on the financial statements. Okay, so the first thing we want to do when we're looking at, you know, something like this is we can kind of remind ourselves in terms of like, how does it work for a manufacturer? And we're going to have raw materials inventory. And we're going to be using essentially our factory payroll. And then we're also going to be using factory overhead. Let's put this over here. And we're also going to have factory overhead. This is going to go into what we call a work in process account. And then ultimately, this is going to be going over here and traveling to our finished goods inventory. And then ultimately, it's going to be going over here to our cost of goods sold. And this whole, you know, this little methodology in terms of how we go through and look at this. If you take a look at any solution manual for these types of questions and you try to go through and compute a cost of goods manufactured, to me, that is incredibly, incredibly difficult. So rather than going through and doing that, let's go through and take a look at these different items over here. So it tells us that Lopez Corporation incurred the following costs during 2025. So it says that work in process inventory was 12,000 at January 1st and 15,500 at January 31st. Finished goods inventory was 60,000 on January 1st and 45,600 on January 31st. Now I have some other videos that I'll link in the bottom of this that kind of go through, you know, how this whole process works, but let's just go ahead and dive right into it. So the first thing we're being asked to do is to compute cost of goods manufactured. Well, what exactly is cost of goods manufactured? It's the cost that we basically completed that's going out of work in process and going over here to our finished goods inventory. What's cost of goods sold? And if you remember when we sold inventory back in financial accounting, we were debiting accounts receivable, crediting sales, debiting cost of goods sold, and crediting inventory. So our cost of goods sold, or COGS, is what's leaving our finished goods inventory and then coming right over here to our cost of goods sold. So we've got all this right over here is kind of setting up our TA accounts, which is always where we want to go through and begin. And let's now take a look at the data. So the direct materials that were used in the product. Now remember, when we have work in process, what is work in process combined of? It's basically the direct materials. It is going to be the direct labor, and it's also going to be the factory overhead. Those are really the three elements that are going to be going into work in process. So where do the direct materials come from? They're generally going to be coming from raw materials inventory. Now, even though the question isn't asking us to do this, I want us to get us in the habit of doing this. So right over here, we've got 120,000, and this is coming from raw materials inventory. We're directly putting this out of raw materials into our work in process. Depreciation on factory. Well, we know that it relates to production because it has the word factory in it. So it's going to go over here to our factory overhead. And our factory depreciation was $60,000. Okay. Property taxes on the store. Okay. So in terms of this one right over here, this is an interesting one because when we think about this, when am I really manufacturing anything out at the store? Well, the store is really where I'm going to be going through and selling something. So I haven't looked at the answer to this question, but for those did I not include in either one, I would be going, so property taxes on the store is going to be over here, and this is going to be a selling, general, and administrative expense. Remember that when we're going through and we're going through and dealing with all of these different types of issues, right? You've got a traditional multi-step income statement, which is sales less cost of goods sold is going to be gross profit, less SG&A, selling general administrative is going to give you your operating income. So this the property taxes on the store, they almost got me, is that's where I would put it. Okay, so labor cost of assembly line workers, right? So if it was store workers, it'd be a selling general administrative, but right over here, the labor cost, this is going to basically be our direct labor. So this would be coming out of factory payroll and coming over here to our work in process. Now, factory supplies used is $23,000. Now, this has the word factory. So we get excited and we're going to go here and say factory supplies is going to be at $23,000. And let's make this a little bit easier for all of us to read. Okay. So we've got factory supplies used is $23,000. Labor costs of assembly line workers is $110,000. Advertising expense, right? So advertising expense. This again, it's a very important part, but this is also going to be a SG&A, part of a selling expense. Okay, property taxes on the factory. We see that magical word factory. So we get excited and we're going to say factory property taxes. So my factory property taxes are going to be $14,000. Now, here's another one, delivery expense. Well, delivery expense is a process of going through and when we're selling it to our customers. That's not a part of the manufacturer, unless it said delivery expense of, you know, raw materials of the factory, but it doesn't say that. So we're basically going to come over here and say delivery expense. And this over here is basically going to be $21,000. Similarly, sales commissions. This is also going to be a selling expense. So our sales commissions are going to be $35,000. And then over here, when we're looking at this last one, which is salaries paid to sales clerks, this is also going to be okay. So my salaries to sales clerks are going to be $50,000. Okay. All right. So we have this all over here. And now what we have to go through and do is fill in the final blanks. Now with factory overhead, we had three costs, depreciation, supplies, and taxes. This totals up here to be $97,000. This balance has to be at zero. So over here, we're going to credit factory overhead for $97,000. That's going to come over here. Showing up here into work in process. Normally too, I might have to close out factory payroll because it might be including indirect labor. But again, we don't have enough. This is an exercise and a problem. So we're dealing with the information we have. Now, when we look at the T accounts to determine cost of goods manufactured, does 12 plus 120 plus 110 plus 97 equal 15.5? And that answer is going to be no, right? So we have to say 12 plus 120, plus 110, plus 97, plus minus X equals 15.5. Another, so again, it's these amounts here minus this is going to give us 15,500. This is why T accounts are so important. So over here, another way we can write this by isolating X is going to be 12 plus 120 plus 110 plus 97 minus 15.5 equals X. Now what we can go through and do is solve for X. And solving for X, we get 3,235. Let's just make sure that this works. 12 plus 120 plus 110 plus 97 minus 3,235 gives us 15,500. This is going to be, this is our cost of goods manufactured. This is going to go to our finished goods inventory. Now, in terms of what goes to cost of goods sold, this is going to be 60 plus 323 minus 45.6 equals 337,900. So again, we want to check our work. 60 plus 323,500 minus 337,9 is 45.6. Again, you could say 60 plus 323 minus Y equals 45.6. 60 plus 323.5 minus 45.6 equals Y. And there you go. And so that's going to be our cost of goods sold. So this is how we go through and solve this particular question. So, and we've included for those costs, not in part A or B, we've basically said what would be included on the financial statement. So I'm going to pause real quick. We're going to see if we got the question right. Everybody, so I'm just going to show you this really quickly. So we got our cost of goods manufactured to be 323,500 and our cost of goods sold to be 337,9, which is exactly what this question here is doing it. But I want you to look at how this is being done. And this is why I'm such a huge advocate for using T accounts to solve these problems. My students, if they looked at this, I mean, and again, you know, when we're looking at managerial accounting, and this is a cost of goods manufactured statement, but if you had to do this in real life, you're probably going to have a reference for it. But if you're trying to compute this stuff on an exam, you don't want to use this. You don't want to, I mean, like using this methodology to me is just nuts. And this is a statement of a cost of goods manufactured. I'm not denying that. But it's not something in my experience and working. I have not really worked for a lot of manufacturers, but again, in my time of when I was a CFO, but again, when I'm looking at this over here from an educational standpoint, do you want to learn it like this, or do you want to be going through and learning it with T accounts? I mean, frankly, this personally to me is a much better visual representation in terms of how to solve these questions. So you can do it whatever way you want to do it, but this is how I would go through and solve this type of a question. But that's what I'm here to do. You can disagree with me, right? We can have a controversial video on YouTube. Wow, look at that. Anyways, I am always open. And by the way, I'm the first one to always admit to my mistakes. But I really want to thank Wiley today for allowing me to use their content. I think it's a great thing just because they are a true believer in not just providing the solution, but actually providing, you know, where did the numbers come from? Look forward to seeing you on the next video and have a great rest of your day.